this year's Ritt fellowships, Peter Teichner, I guess, at this side of the Atlantic. So he got his PhD with Matthias Krick, who you all know very well because he visits here regularly each year. He got his PhD in 92, after which he was in San Diego on, I think it was a Humboldt fellowship, working with Mike Friedman. Then he was at Berkeley on a Miller fellowship and returned to San Diego, where he progressed to full professor, I think, in 1999. And then in 2004, he went to Berkeley and is still a professor at Berkeley. But in 2008, he also became a director of the Max Planck Institute in Bonn. And so he will be speaking to us today. I'll talk about it on screen, isn't it?
Now, if you're a mathematician and you make up this concept, for physicists, this is it. You don't have to think about more surfaces than a sphere. But for mathematicians, now we made up this concept, a space that's locally like R2. But now we want to know what other spaces are there. And this is not, this was not the only possible. So here I have a genus 2 surface, which has, again, locally coordinates, but locally looks very different. So very early on, I don't even go into site for this theorem, surfaces were classified. So surfaces are these two-dimensional manifolds that are compact, so they're finite, and they have no boundary. So that's a closed surface. And I'm going to tell you a fancy way of classifying them, because that's the way that's going to generalize the dimension 4. So these surfaces are classified by the intersection form on their first homology. And here I'm just using Z-mod 2 coefficients in homology. So first homology of a surface is represented by circles. Like this blue circle is one homology class. And so is the yellow, purple, and the red circle. And so in this case of genus 2, the first homology is actually a Z2 vector space of dimension 4. And I've drawn the 4 generators. And well, the dimension of that vector space is not sufficient to classify the surface. But if you, in addition, take into account how these circles intersect, which here actually you can't really see how they intersect because it's not very generic, but I guess you can see that blue and yellow intersect in a single point, whereas purple and blue, they seem to intersect in a single point, but it's not transverse. So if I perturb it, like topologists like to do, then blue and purple will not intersect at all. So anyway, so you can compute the intersection numbers between these circles, and that's called the intersection form. That classifies surfaces. And this intersection form is symmetric. So it's really a symmetric bilinear form. And by what we call Planck radiality, it's unimodular. In other words, if you write down a matrix for the intersection numbers, it's going to have to turn them wrong. So it's a unimodular form. And the theorem is that there's actually a one-to-one correspondence between isomorphism classes of unimodular forms over Z2 and surfaces that are close. And we'll see this again in dimension 4, but in dimension 2, probably each of you has seen this, except maybe in a slightly different language. So let me explain the transition. Well, but first I should give you some more examples than the sphere. So let's start with quadratic forms over Z2. So every quadratic form, so here's one quadratic form, the standard form, lot. And here's another form, that's the hyperbolic form. And every quadratic form over Z2 is a direct sum of these guys. So, or maybe said differently, either if it's even, in other words, if there's zeros on the diagonal, it's a direct sum of hyperbolic guys. And if it's not even, it's the direct sum of ones. That's the quickest way of saying the classification of quadratic forms. And then I claim the projective plane as this one intersection form, but I'm drawing a sphere. So get the projective plane, that's the space of lines through the origin. So imagine a line through the origin, make sure this is meant for so here we have the sphere. Well, the first homology of the sphere, I think everybody sees that. If I have a circle on the sphere, it's going to contract to a point, so it's zero. So that's allowed as a unimodular form, the zero form. But to get an interesting form like this one, projective space is the space of lines through the origin, so it will intersect the sphere, each line will intersect the sphere at 2 points. And therefore, projective space is just the quotient of the two sphere where you identify typical points. And then there's a nice circle, namely the circle that goes from one point to its antipodal along a great circle. And that's the generator, and then when you compute its self-intersection, you get this form. So anyway, so since you know that quadratic forms are direct sum of these guys, then every surface is a direct sum of tori, or a direct sum of RP2s. So So remember, either it's a direct sum of ones on the quadratic function, that means the surface either a connected sum or a sum. Showing you this connected sum corresponds to a quadratic sum. So any surface is either a connected sum of R2s or a connected sum of 2R. And the way to distinguish between them is whether they're oriented or not oriented, or whether the intersection form is even or not. Okay, so here's a picture of a surface. You can actually see it in 3-space, even though it's not embedded in 3-space. This is the Klein ball. This may be the first surface you haven't seen before. And it's an immersion, because you can't embed it in R3. And you can see here is a circle of self-intersection, but otherwise it's very nice. You can see that it's not orientable, because if you walk along it, and you start here on the outside, and you go around, and you come back, you end up on the inside. So this is not an orientable surface. And I leave it up to you to compute the intersection. By 2 matrix, but you should figure it out what it is. It should be a connected sum of things we've seen before. It's not completely obvious. Okay, so this is surfaces, and I wanted to show you one picture of the idea of the proof of the classification, because this will come back to haunt us. So you draw all these curves that represent the basis of homology on your surface. And then you draw them in a minimal way. In other words, if you have superfluous intersections, like if you see one circle and another circle on a surface that look like this, and there is a disk between them, we'll call it a Ritt disk later on, then you're going to just do this little isotopy and make the two circles not intersect. And then once you have this basis of circles that intersect in this minimal way, just cut along them, and then you kind of see what you get. You get a disk, and then the surface will be reassembled from that disk just according to the intersection pattern of the surface. So it's very easy to go back and forth just by the sign. So just remember this idea of the proof domain move. This is what we'll call Ritt later on. It's getting rid of this pair of intersection points between the surfaces. Okay, so we got dimension. Two in our pocket. This is a very nice warm-up. Now, the second thing that you probably, that each of us has probably wondered about is what is the shape of the universe. So we're going to now not be able to leave our universe and look from the outside. We're stuck inside. So the answer we gave for dimension two for the surface of the Earth is not going to work anymore. So we have to ask the same questions. Does it have boundaries? And we don't know yet. Okay, that's the answer. So here, a mathematician is very useful because he or she can say, well, what kind of surfaces are out there? Sorry, what kind of three manifolds are out there? And then we can decide which are closer to the universe and which are not. And I'm going to again concentrate on the cases with no boundary and compact. So it's what we call a closed three manifold. And show you the first examples. The first example is R3, in a three-dimensional space, but that's not compact. So maybe the easiest example of a compact three-manifold is the torus, which is still flat. And it's obtained from a cube like this room, where you identify the top and the bottom, the left and the right wall, and the front and the back wall. In other words, if you look this way, okay, you're going to see past me, and then you're going to see your own back. Right? Or if you look up, you're going to see your own feet. That's the type of space that the three torus is like. But this is flat because it's just obtained from R3 by modding up some translations. The more interesting thing, which is actually curved, is the dodecahedral space. So imagine this regular dodecahedron, and just like for the like this red face, it appears in the back again, that's called red again, and those are the two that are identified. Similarly here, yellow, yellow. Now each of these faces that I've colored here has also a partner in the back. Okay? So there's an opposite heptagon in this dodecahedron. And then if you identify opposite pentagons of the same color, and now you have to say how you identify them. For the cube, we said we just translated. And here in the pentagon, you actually have two ways of identifying it. You can rotate this pentagon to this, like one click this way, or you click it a little further. And in fact, you get three different three manifolds. One is hyperbolic, the other is polar. One is negatively curved, the other is polar. So this is the so called dodecahedral space or the cipher dodecahedral space. So these are two beautiful compact manifolds without bonding, three manifolds. And there used to be a time where people argued that the positively curved one is the universe. So there's some physical intuition behind it, which I'm not going to get into, but there's still a discussion over this could be the right shape or maybe not. So this is very interesting. So again, mathematicians were challenged to figure out what are all possible three manifolds, what can they all, how do all of them look like? And this is a beautiful story, starting with Thurston, who made the infamous geometrization conjecture. That's the prediction on exactly how all close three manifolds look like. Okay. I'm not going to get into it, there are all these beautiful geometries, there's three geometries, and you cut every three manifold into pieces, and then it becomes geometric. So this was quite a long story, and the last pieces of the puzzle were obtained by a Ritt flow, by Richard Hamilton and Gregory Perlman. And the so-called Poincaré conjecture follows. I should have said that before. On the surface, the surface of the Earth is characterized by the fact that any circle on it contracts to a point. It's the only simply connected surface. That's the two-sphere. All the other surfaces had first homology. They had some surface that didn't collapse. And similarly, the Poincaré conjecture dimension 3 says that every three-dimensional manifold where every circle collapses to a point is only more than 3. So that's a consequence of geometrization. So this geometrization was completed, I guess, about 10 years ago. But very recently, a few months ago, David Wise and Ian Hagel finished a couple of other predictions that Thurston made. Oops, I typed it in. The so-called virtual Hacking and virtual fiber predictions. So there's all this exciting work. Even after geometrization, which reduced the problem of all three manifolds to hyperbolic three manifolds, but there are still some predictions of this hyperbolic three manifolds, but even those were now verified. So we have a very good understanding of three manifolds. So let's go to four manifolds. I should say that if you take Lorentz geometry very seriously, really interested in relativity, then you may get some input into the topology of space-time by looking at geometry. So for example, if you think out of some physical reasons that space-time is globally hyperbolic, which I think many people believe, then there is, as a consequence, the four-manifold is just the three-manifold cross R, cross time, so to speak. And that means that you only have to understand three manifolds to understand space-time topologically. But maybe you don't believe, that the space-time is globally hyperbolic, then you have to again try to understand more globally how four manifolds can look like. So anyways, you can ask the same questions as we did in dimensions 3 and 4. And now there's kind of a beautiful thing. If you believe that space-time is closed, you automatically believe that there was a big bang and there will be big crunch-ups, right? So this time had to start sometime and it will end. So there are these direct consequences. And well, flatter curve, that's answered, it's curved because curvature corresponds to mass by Einstein equation, so it can't be flat. Okay, so now let's come to the, again, I'm going to now say, well, if you really want to understand about Lorentz manifolds, well, let's start with the most basic question, the topological form manifolds. And that turns out to be an amazingly interesting story. And somehow, it's much more interesting than dimensions 1, 2, and 3, and 5, 6, 7, 8, up and higher. So it turns out in the classification of manifolds of every dimension, 4 is very special, and I'll explain why that is. So I think that should be related to the fact that 4 is the space-time dimension. Okay, so the 4 manifold has again an intersection form. So just like a surface, when we draw circles on the surface, they intersect because two one-dimensional manifolds intersect the points on a two-manifold. Now if we have a four-manifold, we study surfaces inside of it. Or more precisely, if we have a simply connected four-manifold. So simply connected just means every circle collapses. Let's assume that. Okay? Otherwise we have every finitely presented group appears as the fundamental group of four manifolds. So we want to classify and get into these questions about deciding whether presentation is the trivial group or not. So four manifolds are not classifiable because groups are not recognizable. Presentations are not recognizable. So I'm going to assume the fundamental group is trivial. Every circle collapses. So then you have these two spheres in the four-manifold, and two spheres will then intersect with points again. So we have another intersection form. Now we'll give this on the second homology. Two spheres intersect. And now these intersections, now we have orientative manifolds because they're simply connected. So now we're going to count these intersections with a sign, so they're not z mod 2 value, but z value. So this intersection form of a four-manifold, now we should think of it as a finite rank matrix and as determinant 1, given by concrete reality, it's a unimodular symmetric form. And what Michael Friedman showed is that any unimodular form can be realized. So this is the analogous theorem to the thing that we showed for surfaces. For surfaces, this was really easy because all the forms were just ones and then a bunch of hyperbolic guys, so those we just realized by the projective plane and the torus. This here is much harder because, well, those of you who study parallel forms over the interviews, they know that these modular forms, they themselves are not classified. I mean, we don't have a complete answer what two modular forms are out there in a positive definite case. Okay. And then he showed that if the intersection form is even, this, we had this before, the diagonal entries are all even, then the form characterizes the manifold in any group. For example, if it's the zero matrix, then it's the force field. So the concrete conjecture is a consequence of this theorem. The force field is characterized by saying it doesn't have any surfaces. So this is Friedman's classification of manifolds. And we're gonna very quickly, so these were topological manifolds. Now, if your manifold has a smooth structure, so if the coordinates you have for the local patches, if you change your coordinates, if those changes can be described by smooth transition functions, then you can find very interesting so-called gauge invariants, and I'm not going to talk about this very long, but there's some amazing things which distinguish dimension 4 from other dimensions, so I wanted to mention that. So first of all, these definite forms, you know, think about, maybe I should say algebraically, for a fixed rank, there's finitely many non-isomorphic definite forms, but the number of those grows exponentially with the rank of the matrix. So we have really no way of, I mean, there's a nice formula how the asymptotic works, but we have no way of understanding all of these positive definite forms. These are like lattices in understood, but what Donaldson showed is that if this form arises as the intersection form of a smooth manifold, then it's diagonalizable. So it just has once or minus once over there. Sorry, only once, because it's positive depth. So it has only once over there. So that was the first surprising thing. So that means that many manifolds that Friedman constructed don't have a smooth structure. That's the first big surprise. Second surprise, so this is the existence. Second surprise is the uniqueness. Namely, actually there's not a single form manifold that we know about which has a unique smooth structure. Like in dimensions 1, 2, and 3, once I know the topological type of the manifold, there's always a unique smooth structure. In dimension 4, we have no idea. Like even the 4-sphere, so the smooth bound Gray conjecture is open. On this 4-sphere, there could be one structure, but most likely it looks an answer. And even on R4, there's uncountably many smooth structures. So this is the difference I talked about. If you ask on Rn, you know, how many kinds of higher dimensional calculus is there in dimension n? The answer is 1 unless n equals to 4. There's only one way to calculate to define what a smooth function is on Rn, but on R4 there's uncountable many. So that's and then here down here I wrote down something that's supposed to sound like classification of surfaces. If we combine Friedman and Donaldson, we get this very simple statement. If we start with a smooth manifold, then these definite forms that are complicated don't arise. So every form is definite, it's just a bunch of ones. And if it's indefinite, then we know it's the direct sum of V8 forms and hyperbolic forms. So really, to construct the intersection forms of smooth manifolds, we only need three manifolds. Like before, we only needed the torus and the projective plane doing the reals. Now we need the complex projective plane, which is a form manifold. We need the torus, which is S2 cross S2 in this case, instead of S1 cross S1. So it's a product of two spheres, not a product of two surfaces. And then we need this mysterious Friedman manifold, which has intersection form E8. By Donaldson's theorem, it's not smooth, but it exists, okay? So there's a nice manifold. Topological. And then smooth manifolds can be described up to homeomorphism, which is the cheating part, as the connected sum of these three guys. You know, we have to take many copies of each of these three. So in some sense, this is a fairly satisfactory status, but there's lots of open problems in this. I wanted to very briefly say something about other fundamental groups. As I say, you have to fix the fundamental group and then start to classify the form manifold. In the trivial group, Friedman did this in the topological case, and this is all about topological form manifolds. But amazingly, this is the complete list of other fundamental groups for which we know the classification. So Friedman and Quinn, and independently correctly understood the infinite cyclic groups. And we correct the finite cyclic groups, and then Craig and myself will be in this class of solid groups. These are the first non-abelian fundamental groups for which we know the classification. These are very amazing groups. They have this one relation presentation, but they're still solid groups, very special classical groups. So there's lots that we don't understand. And if you believe that there's some loops in space-time that don't collapse, then you should understand these manifolds, because so far we only understand single connected things. Okay. So now we're going to try to explain a subtlety in the Friedman classification and also some of the main maneuver that you need to understand if you want to classify manifolds of any dimension. This is this whole picture. So now, somehow the server part of my talk is over. have to wake up again and turn on your fourth dimension.
Okay.
So I'm going to try to take you through a way of thinking in dimension four. I hope this is going to work out. So let's see. So I've drawn some pictures here. Actually, Rob has drawn these drawings. These come from our papers. So think of them as you see them. So this in three-dimensional space. I don't know. I mean, this is some convention with us and our brain. Do you all see the flat plane? This boundary is this rectangle. I can see a plane there. Okay. I hope you all see it. It's not really there, but we can all see it. So there's a two-dimensional surface here in R3. And it doesn't end here. This is just, again, for our brain. It just says, there is a two-dimensional plane, but I want to think, want you to think of it as a continuum, okay? And then there's this arc. The red arc is meant to be just the one-dimensional arc, nothing else. But, again, our plane kind of tries to draw this disk here, whose boundary is the red arc and the black arc. So I'm labeling this by W, because this is going to be the Whitney disk. So what I want you to see is, I want you to see a surface and an arc that intersect in two points. And then in addition, there's this Whitney disk which pairs the two intersections. Because if I connect the intersections on one plane, sorry, on the black plane, and then I connect it on the red arc, that's a circle whose boundary is the Whitney disk. And you've seen this picture in dimension two before, but here it is in dimension three. And then Whitney had this beautiful idea a long time ago to get rid of these intersection points by a mover that's now called the Whitney move or the Whitney trick. One way to describe the mover is you pull the red arc down and you get rid of these two intersection points. Also good for the purposes, as you shall see, as I will use this mover. I'm going to use the symmetric mover, where instead of pulling the red sheet down, I'm going to push the black up. So instead of being a flat plane, the black surface has now this flat part, and then it has this little bubble that avoids the red part. And the bubble is made out of two pieces, two Whitney disks. One is in the front and one is in the back. And then it has this nice strip that contains the bubble. Okay, that's strip is there because we have a framing which I will not use in this talk. But for those of you who know, there's always a framing issue to make this extra strip. So anyway, so this is the Whitney move. What it does is it takes some intersections that should not be there, that algebraically we cannot see, because this would be a plus intersection point, this would be a minus intersection point if you oriented things. So when you add them up, you get zero, but geometrically it's there. So to make it geometrically disappear, we do this trick. So this Whitney trick actually is the key to Smale's proof of the cohorism theorems into the higher dimensional Poincaré conjecture. If you have this trick in your pocket, you can prove this in a little bit more severe. You can prove the higher dimensional Poincaré conjectures. But it has some problems in dimension four, and that's what I want you to see, and that those problems are the key to all the complications in dimension four. Okay, so how do we go into dimension four? So far, I've just discussed dimension four. So this is the time for your 4D classes to come on. So, as you know, the way to think about the fourth dimension is at time. Okay. So, now, I want you to think of this picture literally only in the presence. And then when time passes towards the future or the past, this picture will change. And what will change is that when I move away from the presence, the black stuff just disappears. It's not there. The black stuff is concentrated in dimension, in the presence. Whereas the red arc will persist. The red arc stays in time where it is. So that means that in four dimensions, the red arc is actually becoming a red disk, because it's an arc crossing arc, which is a disk. And Clearly the black is a disk. It's concentrated in the presence. But now we can see how these two things in four dimensions intersect. Because the red is everywhere and the black is only in the presence, the intersections happen in the presence. That means that the red disk and the black disk intersect exactly in two points. And now if I move over here, this Whitney move happens in R3, happens in the presence. So I can do the same Whitney move. And what I've explained to you is the four-dimensional Whitney move, because the red stuff goes into past the presence, but it's completely untouched by this Whitney move. So I hope that was clear. The only thing in all the pictures that you will see from now on, whenever you see an arc, when your brain tells you this is an arc, you should cross it with another arc, namely to past and future, and you should really see this. So we're not trained to do that, but I think we can force your brain to think that. Anytime you see a colored arc, you really should see a disk because we're crossing the presence with the thought. So now we'll get back to pictures, but now I wanted to show you this amazing subtlety and frequency here. So if I have an odd form, then Friedman predicts that there's exactly two manifolds that realize this as intersection form. So think about the easiest odd form you can imagine. This is this form one. So we have complex projective plane that realizes the form one. This is the easiest form you can imagine after the zero form. Now what Friedman says is that there is a second manifold which looks just like CP2, but it's not homomorphic. It looks like CP2 to all the algebraic things you can imagine dealing with it. So far, things I've explained, the intersection form, but it's not CP2, it's a different manifold. So this is the subtlety. In the even case, there's only one E8 manifold. So in the even case, we're only one S2 cross S2. The form determines the manifold. In the odd case, there's two of them. And these manifolds, they don't just have the same intersection form, they're homotopy equivalent. Okay, so up to homotopy type, you can't distinguish them. But here is how you can distinguish them. Exactly one of them is smooth when you cross with R. So if you make a 5-manifold, exactly one of them is smooth. Well, CP2 itself is smooth. That means the other guy, call it the Friedman manifold or something. Friedman called it the Churn manifold. I don't know, maybe let's call it the Churn manifold. Anyway, this other CP2 is not at all smooth. Maybe that's why we haven't encountered it in your mathematical life yet. So either it becomes, well, these are equivalent statements. Two of them are crazy. Kirby-Siegmann invariant is just equivalent to becoming smooth crossing the 30 line or becoming smooth after connected sum with S2 cross S2. But the thing I want to concentrate on is an algebraic formulation of this crazy property. So there's a quadratic function tau, which I'll explain on the next slide. So this is a function that lives on the characteristic elements in the intersection form. I'm not sure I should. So lambda in my notation is the intersection form. C is like a two-sphere in the manifold. Lambda CC, that's just intersecting the two-sphere with itself. Here's the intersection, the signature of the intersection form. And characteristic just means that if I take any class and I intersect it with C, then 1, 2, 2, I get the self-intersection of that class. So that's called the characteristic class. So this is all pure algebra. So the right-hand side is some pure algebra you can make out of the intersection form. The left-hand side is geometry. This is something you can read off from the formula. And if the left-hand side equals the right-hand side, then you have CP2. If it doesn't equal it, you have the other guy. Algebra versus geometry, and this is a very nice way of formulating Friedman's theorem. after you understand tau. So all I have to explain to you is tau. And here's the formula. So as I say, C is the homology class. It can be represented by a sphere in the four-manifold, characteristic sphere. And now the sphere will have self-intersections. And you can actually, I'm going to draw a picture here. So we have the sphere, and the sphere goes crazy in this four-manifold, but it self-intersects. And I can assume that the self-intersection points are actually zero. And that means that I can pair them by these Whitney disks. Okay. Now, so this is supposed to be the same picture as we had it before. So that means this arc persists in past and future. So really, is there a question?
Yeah. So, in general, you can really represent homology classes by similar to those rational pieces that are as true.
Oh, yeah, in dimension, in co-dimension 2, you can always represent by sub-manifolds. This is this nice trick that you map to CPN, or CP infinity first, co-dimension 2, and then you take the inverse image of CPN minus 1 and CPN. So, in co-dimension 2, you can represent by embedded surfaces. Here we are in a simply connected four-manifold, so we can represent by immersed spheres. We can get rid of the genes, but we can't get rid of the self-intersections. But we can pair them like this. So this is all the, so all of these arcs, I should remind you, those are now disks, and all of them live on the sphere. So in this picture, I have my sphere, which is mapped to the four-manifold. On that sphere, in the domain, I have these three blobs. There are three disks that map to three different sections of the four-manifold. And the image of these three disks, well, one is this flat disk, one is this disk, and the third one is this disk. And now we can see the difference between four-manifolds and high-dimensional manifolds. If you have a Whitney disk, in higher dimensions, let's say we're studying six manifolds, then we have to get rid of intersections between three manifolds and the six manifolds. Well, the Whitney disk is still two-dimensional, so this three manifold and the Whitney disk will never intersect with the six manifold. But in a four manifold, the Whitney disk will intersect with any other surface. So the fact that this sphere itself can crash back into the Whitney disk, that's a special thing you mentioned. You may argue maybe we can't even embed the Whitney disk, but that's not true. There's some cool universe which make it possible that you embed this just like I showed here. But you cannot avoid the sphere crashing into the Whitney disk. So anyway, this subtle invariant tau and Friedman's theorem measures exactly this effect that only exists in dimension 4. So what you do is you just take the sphere and put for each pair of intersections, you put in the Whitney disk. And then you count how often the Whitney disk and the sphere intersect. And you sum over all the Whitney disks. And that's an invariant which actually turns out to be independent of how you represent this, how you represent the other side. This is a topological invariant just determined by the characteristic elements. And that, so now you can see, let's go through this for CP2. For CP2, CP1 inside of CP2 is a characteristic element. So that's my S. But that S is embedded, so I don't need any Whitney disks. So this tau is zero for CP2. But for the other guy, for the churn manifold, this tau is non-zero because the tau distinguishes it. So that tells us I have this manifold only to be equivalent to CP2. But the generated two-sphere inside of that four manifold is not represented by an embedding. So CP1 and CP2, that's a nice embedded two-sphere representing the generator. But under the homotopy equivalence, under any homotopy equivalence you pick, that CP1 goes into some crazy intersecting two-sphere, And the fact that it is not represented by embedding is because this invariant is not true. So this is the first thing. So we call this a higher order intersection. So what this is supposed to mean is it's not just two surfaces intersecting or one surface self-intersecting, but this is now an intersection between an original surface and a Whitney disk. So the Whitney disk kind of remembers the first order intersections. We call it zero order. This is at order zero, you see these two intersection points. The Whitney disk kind of pairs them up. It says this zeroth order intersection is trivial. But then there's this two-dimensional thing, so it can intersect another surface. So this intersection we call order one intersection. And counting it gives this interesting invariant. So once you've seen first order intersections, it's not so hard to try to imagine second order intersections. And that's exactly the sequence of papers that Rob Chin and I were writing about. So what happens? So this is our sphere, and maybe the sphere itself or some other shape. So remember our convention. If you see this R, or this R, or this R, it's really a disk, right? Because you go into the past and future by crossing the line. So you see, let's say we see here one, two, three, four surfaces. And you see the intersection pattern. So this is how a four-dimensional topologist actually sees what's going on in the manifold. And what happens is these zero-order intersections are paired by this flat Whitney disk, which the brain actually does draw through. And then we did count the number of intersections like this a minute ago. We counted first-order intersections. Well, so what if they are paired again by Whitney disk? Well, then we can count intersection between the second-order Whitney disk and the mixture. So this guy is an intersection of order two. So this is what we started to study. So we call them higher order Whitney disk. So this is the original Whitney disk, order one. This would be order two Whitney disk. And on it, you see an order two intersection. So now, once you understand higher order Whitney disks, you're going to construct Whitney towers, meaning that you have a surface, or maybe several surfaces, depending on the setting. So sometimes, like red and blue may belong to one surface, maybe they belong to two surfaces. That's not so relevant in these pictures. But the idea is that you just look at all the intersections that you see between those surfaces. And whenever you compare two of these intersections, you're going to put in a Whitney disk. And then you're going to again intersect all the other stuff with that Whitney disk. And when two more are paired, you're going to put in the next Whitney disk and intersect. So that's called a Whitney tower. So iteratively put in more and more Whitney disks to pair as many intersection points as you can. So this is a Whitney tower. And maybe this is too fast. So now I want to organize. Let's go back. So I want to organize this mess, okay? So these are a bunch of surfaces and Whitney disks. I want to organize this mess. So what I'm going to do is, you see there's this very wide red disk. It has two arcs on it. I'm going to simplify that by I'm going to push down this arc. So I'm going to make two Whitney disks, which each has just one arc. Similarly, this Whitney disk has an intersection point and an arc. I don't like that. I'm going to split it down here. I'm going to make two with each has only one problem. So maybe this is not the result. So remember, this is the thing I did in order to separate this arc and that arc. This is the thing I did to separate these two. But then once I separated these two, I get two arcs again, so I should push those down. So what did this do? This did the following good thing. It produced more Whitney disks, but each Whitney disk has only one problem on it. each Ritt disk, like this guy, has either an arc or, like this guy, a single intersection point. So we made progress, we simplified it, because all the Ritt disks in this picture have only one problem on it, an arc or an intersection point. So this is what we call splitting the Ritt tower. And once you have a split Ritt tower, you can see how to use trees, trivalent trees, to organize this Ritt tower. So you go to each, like one intersection point, and from this one intersection point, let me start over again. For each of the Ritt disks, you put a trivalent vertex in the middle, like here. And then each Ritt disk has three directions to go. You can go down to the two arcs whose boundary form the Ritt disk. Or you can go up into the problem. Each Ritt disk has a single problem. Okay? And so like this triangle vertex can go down and then it connects to this guy and then goes up into the problem. Once you hit a single intersection point, that's where the tree ends. Okay? So this crazy Ritt tower is actually organized by these three trees. So this is supposed to turn a crazy four-dimensional picture into a one-dimensional picture where you only have a bunch of triangular trees that tell you how the tower looks like. Okay, so now, so what did we do? So we tried to make a mathematical theory out of this mess. So what we did is, and I don't want to explain that mathematical theory, this is a different talk that I actually already gave in the topology seminar here a year ago, and we still had topologists. So anyway, this is a long story. Basically what we did is we took this Whitney Towers and we try to understand the case of the four ball. The easiest one unfold is the four ball. And when you have a Whitney tower and the four ball, then the boundary is a bunch of circles. So what you start with really is you start with a link on the three sphere. And you ask, for a given link, what is the largest Whitney tower in the four ball that bounds this link? So we build a filtration of links in the free sphere by the height of the Ritt tower that bounds in the four ball. So that's what we did. We wrote down this filtration. And then in the sequence of papers, we completely computed. That's kind of the amazing thing. I mean, there's been other examples. Yeah.
Four papers. Is there any guarantee that this iterating matrix terminates in the middle of the finite?
Well, it depends on the question. So the question was whether this will terminate. And the answer is, let's say this guy doesn't exist. In other words, this Ritt trick is embedded. So if it won't stop, well, either you have to keep going or there is no intersections. Well, then you do the Ritt trick. And you push down this intersection point and this arc is gone. You push down this intersection point. All it means is that some branch is not there. But you still are stuck with these. And then maybe another answer is this filtration we define measures exactly the question whether a given link bounds the Ritt tower of a certain height. Certain links, so-called slice links, even bound in disjointly embedded disks in the four ball. And the disjointly embedded, I mean, a disk for us is as good as an infinite Ritt tower, because when you have a disk, arbitrary height. So really we're trying to find obstructions for links being sliced. So anyway, so the surprising thing is you can completely compute this thing. And I'm going to just put down the table and I'm not sure I should go through it, but the cool thing is out of these crazy surfaces you can actually compute finitely generated really groups. So just very quickly, I'll take you through this. So we're studying links in the three-sphere. And we get a group by saying that we study those guys that bound with the tau order n, multiple those that bound with the tau order n plus 1. So this filtration has an associated gradient, and that turns out to be a medium group. And we can completely compute these medium groups, so I guess these numbers are the number of components, and these numbers is the order of the Ritt tower. If you have knots, one component, well, the Z is the framing, the Z2 is the R invariant, and then the zeros mean that a knot whose R invariant is trivial bounds the Ritt tower of arbitrary order. So I think that's very surprising. That's actually something Rob proved before this computation, but it also follows from the computation. So these zeros are there. But then as soon as you go to 2, then these powers here will grow polynomially, and they have to do with the 3D algebra on this number of components. And the 3D algebra on one component is very boring. That's why you have all this stuff up here. But as soon as we go to 2, 3 or more, these numbers will grow. And there's a bunch of things we don't know in this table, these C2s. So maybe for the experts, I should say that the invariants you see there, these are Milner invariants and Sato-Levine invariants and Clark invariants. One theorem that is very surprising is these leading groups have only Z's and Z2's. So there's no three torsion, no four torsion. So this is a very surprising fact. Not at all understood, it just follows from the computation. But the fact that there's no other torsion than two torsion was a very big surprise. And the fact we can't compute these guys, this is a question about the so-called Concevich integral for links, whether you can define that in open fields or not. Concevich integral is a rational invariant, it's actually a quantum invariant. But the reason we don't know the answer here is that we don't know the Z-mod 2 version of that. Okay. So the key to these computations, the reason these groups are finitely generated, is that we rediscovered the Jacobi identity for the algebras from this, we just discovered this relation, and this is the Jacobi identity, if you read it the right way. And that's why these numbers that we saw have to do with the ranks of the algebra. So you all know the Jacobi identity in the algebra, which is the derivative of associativity in the group. You may have not seen it in this way, so let me just tell you why this is Jacobi. Fix this index 4, let's say, just erase it and put a little root on this, and think of the indices 1, 2, and 3 as three elements in the algebra, x1, x2, x3. And think of the trigon vertex as forming the V bracket. So this picture says that when I go from 1 to 2, and I'm at this edge, I have the element x1 bracket x2. And then I go here, and then I bracket this x3. And 4 is just like a placeholder. So this is the first term in the Jacobi identity. Here I get another term. Here I first bracket 2 and 3, and then I bracket 1. And here I bracket, let's see, 1 and 3 first, and then with 2. So this is a picture. This is the so-called IHX relation by Barnatan, but maybe it's the Jacobi identity, except it's a little more symmetric because now I have only, here I really have four indices which are pretty much symmetric. To make the Jacobi, I have to say that 4 is a special thing, it's like a placeholder, whereas these three guys serve as writing down the three terms of the Jacobi identity. Okay, so now after all this preparation, I wanted to show you how we get to the front page of this proceedings of the National Academy. So I'm going to produce Jacobi, and in the end, you should see the Borromean rings. So I'm going to start And again, we have to think four dimensionally. So really, what you see are four circles, but what you should know that there's around is there's four two spheres here in the four space. So like this circle number three shrinks to a point in the presence into the future and shrinks to a point in the past. So it's really a two sphere. And number four, let's say it's the flat R2, 1 point from amplified, that's the last two spheres. So here are four two spheres. And I started off locally, so anywhere in my four manifold I can go locally and I can put these four two spheres into the story. They're nice and disjoint, no problem. Now I start messing up the picture, and when I'm done, I'm going to see the three terms of the Jacobian. That's the idea. And that means that any time I have my Whitney tower, I can change the trees that arise in the Whitney tower by the three terms of the Jacobian, because I can always add these four to two spheres, make some complicated image I'll show you, and then add it into the Whitney tower, and then I add the trees that are right there, I have to add the terms of Jacobi. And that makes these groups finally degenerate because they're related to the objects. So in this maneuver, I'm going to produce pairs of intersection points between this fourth sphere and the others. So the fourth sphere is really, you know, it's like this table, it's the flat R2. And then from the bottom, we had these two spheres down here. And then we poke them up, and they hit the table, and then come out of the table. And I have these three pairs of intersections. And then I pick the Whitney disks. And the numbering is just that four is the flat table, and two is red, and three is black, and one is blue. So I have this picture. And now, what I did here is, these have disjoint arcs, and I'm going to take that arc and make it more complicated. I'm going to make it into this arc. Okay? And similarly, this Whitney disk is now going to go parallel to the table, like this, and it's going to produce intersections with the red arc here. Okay, so this is a pair of intersections between red and black, even though I have nothing to start with. But there's a Whitney disk, the boundary this guy, which you can see here, it's now pairing 2, 3, and 4, and this Whitney disk ends up intersecting with blue. So I have a 2, 3, 4 Whitney disk, and that's one of the three terms in the Jacobian. Now this is not good because now the black arc intersects the blue arc, intersects the red arc, so here's the tree. So I just drew in the tree. Remember, I have to put a trigonal vertex on each Whitney disk. So here's one trigonal vertex. Here's another one. This is this Whitney disk. And then I have to use these arcs to go down to the intersection points, or up into the next problem, down to the intersection points. And you see the four one-valent vertices are 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so we see this one guy, and then what I claim is that once we get rid of these intersection points by pushing blue out of the way and red out of the way, just by the symmetry of this picture, this is completely rotationally symmetric, we're going to actually see two more of these trees, and those are the three terms of Jacobi. So I'm not going to do all those bad stuff, but now, after you push the arcs out of the way, you get this picture. And that was the goal of my lecture. Thank you for listening. Different living powers between the four arcs. they're all sequences of these numbers I showed you, so they're all relations coming from the triple deviation. I mean, there's a bunch of others that tell you exactly what trees you should use and stuff like that, but that's not sure about you.
Is there a short answer for why those are deviation?
No, there's no short answer why this is a very difficult theorem. And it's not a jet like this theorem only holds in the four-ball. And it only holds for those groups we can actually calculate. So in some cases we saw there's Z2 to some unknown power. There we don't know that. And in the general four-manifold, we don't know that. So we use Miller's invariants, for example. The fact that Miller's invariants are invariants, that's an important step to showing that the triple deviation is the only relation.
So
the interesting thing is it's not an invariant of the thing itself. I mean, that's how we set it up. We wanted to get obstructions for the links bounding embedded disks. And we compute these invariants by choosing a Ritt power as high of an order as we can, and then looking at its intersection. And if we see an intersection, we prove that that's a well-defined invariant of the next order. So the original link came out of this slice. Similarly, if you're in a closed form manifold, you could say if I have a sphere, some homology class, and I want to know whether it's represented by embedding, I can again count this. And this Friedman invariant is tau, it's like the first case, but what we're saying is there's arbitrarily high order analogs of Friedman. So they cannot arise in a simply connected manifold because of this result, but they will arise in the or additional invariants you have to consider when you want to classify it once you connect form. So there's not just the intersection form, but there's all these higher order intersections. This is algebraically not at all understood.
Is this classified as smooth form or topological?
This works in both categories. But the point is, if you have a topological Ritt power of order 5, let's say, and you perturb it a little bit, let's double it. If you have a topologically embedded sphere, and you perturb it a little bit, it's not embedded anymore. It's smooth, but it's not embedded, right? If you have a crazy embedded sphere. But if you have a Ritt power topologically embedded, you perturb it, well, you create new intersections. But you can prove that the height of the Whitney tower is unchanged. In other words, the intersections you create can also bound a smooth height and tower. So that means for these invariants, there's no difference between smooth and topological. It's too soft, so it's smooth to see the difference.
Yeah. That's a big. Thank you very much.